Thank you all for coming, and thank you for waiting too. My name is Nyayo Chua, and I'm delighted to be here on this Nuer Nation book launch today. First of all, I'd like to say thank you to all of you. Thank you to all the sponsors of the event. Thank you to the Nuer Nation Language Preservation Project. Thank you to New Life Ministries that sent Michaela, our speaker will be speaking later. Thank you to Miyongkwan, an individual also who has helped us a lot. Thank you also, Yual, for coming over from Canada to come and launch your event in Omaha. Thank you, Kumaj, for the media coverage. We'll not forget you. Thank you, Gaj, back there, for everything you've done. For the flyer, you've seen the flyer, he's the one behind it, he's the one who designed it. Today, this week has been actually a low week for the Nuer Nation. We've been losing people, maybe since 2013, but the peak of today, I think there are like 4 or 5 funerals going on. So we've lost a lot of people in our society. So just like us, maybe observe a minute of silence for all the souls that have been lost since 2013, before that and now. So anyway, we are going to try to smile, because we are running on this world. We need to persevere too. We don't know when we're going to leave. So while you're here, make sure that you have a purpose and you fulfill your purpose in life. To the book launch, I'd like to introduce to you today the reason why we're here. We're here to launch the Nuer Nation book. It has been written by 3 authors, Kwa Jin Loy, Witch Tor, Peter Guy Manuel, and Dr. Yual Chiek. Dr. Yual Chiek is the mastermind behind the book and the idea. I'll give you some biography, a little biography about the 3 writers. Mr. Kwa Jian is a PhD candidate of international law at the University of Hamburg in Germany. He holds an MA in public policy and good governance, and in public economics, law, and politics. Mr. Peter Guy Manuel also is a South Sudanese who is a PhD candidate in Kenya. He holds holds a bachelor degree in journalism and mass communication from St. Lawrence University in Uganda. Dr. Yual Chiek, who will be here today speaking about the book, holds a PhD in philosophy from Queen's University, Kingston, in Canada, and he was also a visiting assistant in research at the Yale University from 2011 to 2013. He also co-authored a book by Leibniz, with Leibniz, on compossibility and possible worlds. So without further ado, join me in welcoming Dr. Yual Chiek.
For the introduction, I should say a few things, not so much in correction, but maybe elaboration. In terms of mastermind of the book, I did a video, or a YouTube video a few months ago, or maybe it was last year, commenting on Brexit, and about how I think that there are some commonalities between what happened with the British thing, and why it might be possible for the Nuer themselves to have a state, and why that might alleviate some of the pressures that result in the atrocities that we see in South Sudan and other places in the world. So in that respect, I suppose I'm a mastermind. In terms of the book, the idea for the book itself was Chiek. Chiek contacted me after seeing the video and said, you know what, I agree. I think that this is the trajectory we should follow that might alleviate, as you rightly point out, the pressures that we see in much of Africa. And then we started talking about things such as the Treaty of Westphalia in 1648, and about how that was the breakup of mass multinational states that we saw, like Holy Roman Empire and so forth, and giving essentially ethnicities their own states in Europe, which alleviated a lot of the pressure, leading eventually, at least one of the biggest factors that led to European development. And so we reasoned that, why wouldn't that be the case in Africa? So in that respect, we have to give props to Chiek, right, on the idea of the book. So what I'm going to do today is I'm actually going to read with some commentaries chapter 4 and 5 of the book itself. Because in chapter 4 and 5, that's where we actually lay out why it is that the Nuer could have a state, what the benefits would be, and mostly how this would affect the development of the people. We try to take a realistic look at all the factors that have happened, all the things that are going on in South Sudan, such as differences in relative differences in wealth, education among the various ethnic groups, but what that brings about in the long run in terms of cultural or social hegemonies. So, the presentation will last about an hour. I know usually maybe 45, 50 minutes. And forgive me if the language is a little dense. I think that that sometimes when talking about these are rather serious things. So it's important that when you're stating something as big as, well, I think this group of people should secede from a country, you have to make sure that all your ducks are in a row. You've got to make sure that you consider all the options because it's not a simple or small thing. But I think that that we're between a rock and a hard place, as it were, right? And this is what I'm going to try and point out, that if the Nuer people stay in the current situation, there's only social hegemony of one group over another, which will eventually create more violence. That is a fact, for all intents and purposes, in terms of the things that we've looked at in human history. And there's no reason to think that'll ever stop. On the other hand, there's this possibility that if they go and form a state, that the fact that that Nuer understand other Nuer would alleviate some of the causes for inter-ethnic conflict. So you'll see that I'll use the example of Europe quite a bit, because I think, in large respects, I think it's best to think of South Sudan as Europe, not as any single country in Europe. So that's a sort of laying out the conceptual groundwork. So without further ado, let me begin. And afterwards, if there are any questions, please take notes. I'd like for us to have an interesting conversation about this. Sorry. So, let me begin by motivating the need for a Nuer state by highlighting the fact that the Nuer are and always have been a proud and independent people. And I do this with the aim of making clear that the Nuer have always been in possession of a sense of independence that is prerequisite for existing as a state. We also add to this the theory of the observations of outsiders that the Nuer are in fact in possession of a state that they, the Nuer, understand in their own terms. We argue in the book the fact that the genocide on the Nuer people was committed in a full view of a silent, international community alone are sufficient reasons for the Nuer to secede from South Sudan. All of these things have happened to the Nuer despite their foundational and consistent contributions to the independence of South Sudan. Of course, this mass murder of our people would not be acceptable even if the Nuer were not as critical or as important to the formation of South Sudan as they in fact are. But the Jinka genocide of our people is all the more indicative of a broader Jinka plan for the establishment of deeper socioeconomic disparities between the Dinka and everybody else in South Sudan. This motivation could be considered a particular motivation in as much as it's concerned with the struggle between the Nuer and the Dinka. Of course, there are other things going on in South Sudan. It isn't always just between Nuer and Dinka, but them being the two largest groups, if there are two elephants fighting in the room, maybe the effect of the mouse that's in the room is oftentimes negligible, not always. Right. We do, however, also make a more general motivation for Nuer secession, which consists in the claim that pre-Westphalian Europe was in a similar situation to what South Sudan is today, when in the grips of a near-century-long war between various ethnic groups. Those were only ended when territories were divided along ethnic lines, thus creating a modern state system we have today. We therefore argue that this solution would work in South Sudan. Even though it may be unintuitive to some, the eventuality and tractability of ethnic conflict in South Sudan requires that South Sudan be conceptualized not as a state, and certainly not as a nation, but as a region. The last part of the chapter surveys and addresses some arguments against the formation of a Nuer state. So let's move on to motivation. As of this writing, last year, it appears that we're witnessing the breakdown of the European Union. As a political and monetary union that in many ways has run roughshod over economic and social differences that exist among European nation states, the EU has ceded the causes of its own crumbling. Great Britain has already exited from the EU. Marie Le Pen of the French Nationalist Party is pushing for a referendum to take France out of the EU, the Frexit, as it's been called. And there is a rise of Eurosceptic sentiment in countries like Italy, Sweden, Australia, Denmark, and even a few in Germany itself. That's important because Germany is essentially holding the EU together. It is a live possibility that Brexit will be repeated in other European countries. Even states in which there has not been a political push for exit from the EU have seen a rise in extremist nationalist parties. These developments are symptomatic of a political project that seems to refuse to recognize the permanence of the nation state. It seems quite clear that a bulk of the concerns animating the popular desire to exit from the EU are cultural rather than economic. The motivations undercurrent of Brexit are a desire to preserve not only sovereignty of the nation state, but also the cultural and ethnic homogeneity of European states, or at least that of England, as far as we're talking about Brexit. To a greater magnitude and for a longer period of time, the same thing has happened in Africa, insofar as the undercutting of the nation state is concerned. The vast majority of African states are not nation states. In fact, most of these states were former European colonies that were smatterings of various ethnic groups. Naturally, there was no consideration of whether these peoples in the new states would live peacefully. Division of African lands into colonies was done only considering the interests of European powers, not the peoples that would live within these countries. Now, an aside here, so oftentimes you hear things like this and you might think that, well, what were the Africans doing? Maybe it was just some passive thing. Of course, it wasn't easy. You don't just make a map somewhere, cut it up and say, well, we're gonna cut these people's lands and then we're just gonna tell them, well, you guys live here now. It wasn't a smooth process. There was some fighting, people died, right? So it wasn't exactly this, it wasn't like the Africans were passive in this, right? So that should highlight the reason why it was done. It was done for economic reasons, and it was done in view of future gains that would be made. So again, that's just to highlight the fact that we have to keep that in view. So parsing Africa into colonial holdings did not take into account existing animosities or territorial disputes between ethnic groups. That is to say, when we look at a political map of Africa, the shapes that we see are not African shapes. They are at their core European shapes, no matter how much one may attempt to Africanize them. Much of this division was justified by the idea that the highest level of social organization Africans had attained to was the level of tribe. This is, to be sure, thinly veiled racism, but it did nevertheless offer justification for the notion that any assemblage of African tribes can form a nation. When independence movements swept through the continent, the structure of African states remained unchanged. But of course, competition between ethnic groups for position within the new independent states did not cease, but actually began in earnest. From then to now, popular understanding has attributed the problems of Africa to tribalism with little to no appreciation of the origins of this notion of things, that is, the tribalist notion. In sharp contrast to this, we see in Europe the breakup of large multinational states into smaller, more ethnically homogeneous nation states. So the reverse trend was happening in Europe. So this is a map, 1000 CE. CE is just current era, which means after death, right? So it's 1000 AD. So after the breakup of the Roman Empire, much of Europe, Great Britain and so forth, Europe even gets its name from, it's a Greek name actually, it's named after Europa, I think the goddess of hunting, I think. And then, so much of that, Germania or Britannia was colonized by the Romans. Once the Roman Empire broke down, some of these larger groups, for instance, the Franks, France and Germany used to be called Francia, and then there used to be the Visigoths who formed now some of the states that we have. But as you see there, the map is quite different from our current map. There used to be larger states that would house a lot of ethnicities. So what happened? People started fighting because there wasn't human security. I'm afraid that the guys on the other hillside are going to come and destroy my place. So people started fighting. 1648, there's a large council. People decided we can't do this forever, so maybe we need to break up these large states into more ethnically homogenous ones, and then the relationships we have will be of trade. Because I'm not coming to take your stuff, you're not coming to take my stuff, but you've got something I need, I've got something you need, so let's begin trading. And that process continued until we have the European trading bloc, which then became the European Union. So again, in sharp contrast, we saw in Europe the breakup of multinational states into smaller, more ethnically homogeneous nation states. The rationale for the breakup of these states was that it is necessary to recognize each nation's right to rule in its own land and by its own people. This was a principle, if only implicit and incomplete, part of the Treaty of Westphalia. An early recognition of this fact, negotiated in the Westphalian cities of Munster and Unisbruck in Germany, present-day Germany, this treaty is credited with laying the foundations of the modern state system of world order. putting an end to the 80 years war between the Spanish and the Dutch, and with putting an end to the German portion of the 30 years war. The treaty was especially noteworthy because it presented a formal articulation of the concept of territorial sovereignty, a concept that undergirds much of international law. The negotiations began in 1644, and the Spanish-Dutch portion was signed on January 30, 1648. The part of the treaty that comprehended the Holy Roman Emperor, Duke Ferdinand III, the other German princes at the time, because the Holy Roman Empire was mostly centered in Germany, what is today Germany, there were something like 300 German princes with their own territories, and they had more federalist leanings. Of course, the Holy Roman Empire had more imperialist leanings. And then you throw into that Lutheranism, and you've got the Reformation, rather, and then you just sparked the 30 Years' War in Germany. Apart from territorial changes that redrew the map of Europe and the settlements that guaranteed the free practice of religion of Roman Catholics, Lutherans, and Calvinists within Europe, an important result of the peace, as far as our purposes is concerned, is that it brought a definitive end to the monarchical tendencies of the Holy Roman Empire over the German princes, while simultaneously affirming the federalist aspirations of the German princes. As a result, the central authority of the Holy Roman Empire was replaced by the sovereignty of over 300 German princes, each with sovereignty over their individual lands. What is more, the Peace of Westphalia recognized the full territorial sovereignty of its member states, and the member states were allotted the right to contract treaties with other states within the empire and with foreign powers so long as the empire was not legally prejudiced in any of these treaties. This and other changes ensured that the Holy Roman Empire retained only a shadow of its former power. Its sovereignty replaced by the sovereignty, entirely by the sovereignty of the German princes over their own lands. The Holy Roman Empire also lost significant portions of its territorial landholdings. This effectively marked the end of the Holy Roman Empire and the rise of the nation-state powers in Europe. The fact, however, that German lands were still technically part of the Holy Roman Empire, and that guarantors of the peace, France and Sweden, reserved the right to interfere in the affairs of the empire, meant that for years to come, Germany would be the stage of European war and diplomacy. This would mean that the national development of German-speaking people was long delayed. While most European nation states had well-defined national identities, the Germans would cycle through several confederations of German states and an empire before finally coming to the Germany we know it. The crucial takeaway from the discussion in the preceding paragraphs, and let's just see what happened after that. So this is Europe, 1648. Some shapes you can recognize. We're recognized as Portugal, Spain, Kingdom of France, England, Ireland, Scotland. But look at Germany. Versus Bohemia. Such thing as a kingdom of Bohemia today. And the Germany has all those like tiny little places. The Switzerland doesn't quite look like it used to. And look at Italy. Italy hadn't unified yet, right? So the maps that we see today are not necessarily the same as the maps of long ago. Political boundaries shift, and they always will shift. Let's not forget that these are just ideas. The land, the earth, isn't actually marked out in this way. These are just ideas in people's minds, right? So what we do is we ought to have the freedom to change the ideas in our whenever we wish. And the only condition should be whether or not it's good for the people. The people are not made for the ideas. The political ideas are made for the people. We need that to sort of free ourselves. So in fact, it was recognition of the nation state that helped to end a great deal of instability within Europe. With peace in Europe came a dramatic increase in the overall development of the continent and its people. It is also telling that with peace and development that was afforded by the creation of the nation state system in Europe began the period of European colonization of Africa in the 19th century. The scramble for Africa, as it was called, left only Abyssinia, known today as Ethiopia, and Liberia as independent nation states. So, Sudan and Egypt were never going to any colony as say, per se, but as a result of the British occupation of 1882, were subsumed under British administration until 1922. The implication is clear. Without the union of Europe into nation states, it is unlikely that Europe had the intra-continental political ability to engage in the conquest of Africa, establishing colonies therein, or in other parts of the world. Good evidence for this can be drawn from the fact that colonies in Africa began failing as a result of two successive and devastating world wars that decimated much of Europe, because there was no money or manpower to keep the colonies. In addition to domination, the question we ask in this world, why Africans should deny themselves, particularly Nuer, what has proven to be in the land of their colonizers, and promises to be at once a powerful element in the elimination of destructive wars and the production of development and peace. In any event, we submit that Africans may do as they please, but we mean that their people must move towards that which ancestors envisioned and push forward with the speed and verb of manifest destiny. The task at this time is not to expand our borders, but to make the best use of the territory that we do have for the perfection of Nuer civilization. Kinship state built upon a strong distance on egalitarianism and reverence for the freedom of the Nuer person. In short, we unabashedly call for the perfection of the revision of life, a vision that even outsiders have seen clearly. European commitment to the idea of the nation state did not end with the Treaty of Westphalia. After World War II, there came a need to reinforce the nation state ideal that was first articulated in Westphalia. At the Treaty of Versailles, American President Woodrow Wilson presented his 14 points, which were designed to facilitate lasting peace in Europe. While dealing with particulars such as the adjustment of colonial claims, the restoration of occupied territories, the rightful states, the core that runs through all of Wilson's points, however, is the expansion and preservation of the nation-state ideal for the European continent. Although Truman ambiguously gestures that the interests of the populations of these colonies have as much weight as the claims of a colonial government of that regime. As a matter of course, the interests of the population, sorry, not Truman and Wilson, ambiguously gestures that the interests of the population of these colonies have as much weight as the claims of the colonial governments of that regime. As a matter of course, the interests of the population were more understood as the colonial powers providing improvements in labor conditions for native populations. So, concern for the interests of the native populations went as far as to say you need to give them better working conditions. Well, what should just be working conditions? Because the establishment of the colonies was for home country, to gain resources and so forth, right? So you want to make sure that workers have better working conditions. But of course, people within these countries thought it is the working conditions we're looking for. We're looking for social stability and independence. And so, but that's going to put us at a loggerheads. We want something that you don't want for us, right? Conflict ensues, decolonization begins. So, naturally, the development and solidification of native national identities, much less nation states, could not be recognized. The story was different in Europe. Even during World War I, the ideal of the nation-state and the notion that state authority had to be derived from the community caused nation-states to expand social and political inclusion to all the members of the national community in the name of full cohesion of that particular nation-state. So, in other words, in Europe, Woodrow Wilson was arguing is that, look, you should focus on this on the nation state. In fact, you should put things together so that people solidify themselves as that particular nation state. So the Swiss feel more Swiss. So that the Danes feel more Danish. So that you can include all people within. And then from there, after you've got the Danish feeling more Danish, then you can have the Europeans feeling more European. But in Africa, that could be put in place because if the Africans started doing that, then of course colonies would break up. So this is the interwar period between 1929 and 1939, just before World War II. So you start to recognize now that the states seem a little bit different. Italian speaking peoples are sort of united there. So Italy looks a little bolder. You see Germany. So it's closer to states that we have today. So I just want to know that this is a process that's occurring over time. We started in 1648, actually 1000 AD, or 76 AD if you want to point it back to the fall of the Roman Empire, right? And then it's just what's happening. Nation states are getting more concrete. And as that process occurs, then more and more peace. And then you start to even see various these other nation states starting to see, well, you know what, we actually have one thing in common. We're all Europeans. So, but you can't get to the point without going through this intervening point. But in Africa, we seem to want to do things in reverse, or we seem to want to jump all the steps, which is a patent impossibility. It can't be done. So it was the promise. So there came a need to reinforce the nation-state ideal. The story was different in Europe during World War I. The ideal of the nation-state. So while it was a promise, eventual independence from colonial powers, united independence movements that would take place in Africa, China, and India, the states that Africans pushed for were not the true nation-states that are in Europe, because the notion of national community, the nation-state model requires, wasn't there. Unfortunately, the colonies were political entities that forced many different ethnic groups into one political area. This meant that once a state becomes independent, there would be an eventual conflict between ethnic communities within the states for political power. In effect, the African push for independence only served to remove European control. It did not create the nation-state that were at play in Europe. In fact, post-colonial Africa bears more resemblance to pre-Westphalian Europe than the state ideal that Europe had entered into at the signing of the Westphalian Peace and reinforced at the Treaty of Versailles some 270 years later. One clear and ready at hand mission for the Nuer to secede from South Sudan is the unprecedented and dehumanizing violence that has been inflicted upon them. Added to violent is persistent systemic policies to disenfranchise the Nuer people of their resources and deny educational opportunities, and the development they were by the government of a state they envisioned, argued, and fought for. Despite their foundational contributions to the establishment of Sudan, they've been labeled terrorists or unconfirmed, when it was they who never wavered from the cause of independence of South Sudan. Indeed, it is only not that have ever been confirmed. They've also suffered the erasure of seminal contributions to the establishment of this country, including their founding of the very movements, the first movements to fight for the independence and have the backbone of the SPLA, SPLM, as you can see, recruitment numbers. Nuer formed some 70 or more percent of the SPLA army. In place of the true history has been erected a spurious history that either erases whole episodes, fabricates events that never occurred, attributes new accomplishments to Dinka, casts events in a false or exaggerated light, or downplays the importance of Nuer achievements. There's more, the Nuer have been subject to relative exclusion from all selective political positions in the country. And all of these, they have suffered silently, not to take arms or even engage in civil unrest, not for the fear of the regime, but for fear that the stability of the new country would be put at risk. They have instead reiterated time after time the proper procedural channels that all such women of the Nuer and other peoples in the country should stop at once a system of government that respects the rights of all South Sudanese be established. They have tirelessly written and campaigned for the need to eliminate corruption in government and to implement transparency and openness in government. for their efforts in fearlessly standing and speaking for rights and benefits of all, they have received the worst mass killing in South Sudanese and Sudanese history by the government they were integral in creating. That same government has used the public purse to employ foreign mercenaries and foreign states to destroy their populations. So, Nuer would be well within their rights to exit from South Sudan. Nor would they be the first nation to ever part of the state for these reasons. The most example of a people unlatching from a country that has done such wrong as the United States of America. In their Declaration of Independence, the American Founding Father eloquently wrote, "When in the course of human events it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with another, and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal status, station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitle them, a decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they declare the causes which impel them to the separation. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. They are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights. Among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their powers from the consent of the governed. That whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of people to alter or to abolish it. And to institute new government, laying its foundations on such principles and organizing its powers in such form as to them shall seem most likely in happiness. Prudence indeed will indicate that governments long established should not be changed for light causes. This is still the Founding Fathers' view. And accordingly, all experience has shown that mankind are more disposed to suffer while evils are sufferable than to right themselves by abolishing the forms to which they are accustomed. But when a long train of abuses and usurpations, pursuing invariably the same objective, evinces a design to reduce them under absolute despotism, it is their right, it is their duty to throw off such government and to provide new guards for their future security. Such has been the patient suffering of these colonies, and such is now the necessity which constrains them to alter their former systems of government. The history of the present King of Great Britain, is a history of repeated injuries and usurpations, all having in direct object the establishment of an absolute tyranny over these states. To prove this, let facts be submitted to a candid world." That was the American Founding Father speaking. And I suggest to you, it sounds eerily similar to what's going on in South Sudan. Again, there truly is nothing new under the repeated. Near to the end of the list of grievances that follows this paragraph that I just read, there is one that, again, that is eerily close to the crimes of this present Dinka regime led by Salva Fakir has committed against the Nuer people. So the Founding Fathers say, "He, King George of England, has plundered our seas, ravaged our coasts, burnt our towns, and destroyed the lives of our people. He is at this time transporting large armies of foreign mercenaries to complete the works of death, desolation, and tyranny begun with the circumstances of cruelty and perfidy scarcely paralleled in the most barbarous ages, and totally unworthy of the head of a civilized nation. He has constrained our fellow citizens, taking captives on the high seas to bear arms against their country, to become the executioners of their friends and brethren, or to fall themselves by their hands. We submit that the Nuer people have no less a right to dissolve the political bands that attach them, that attach them to the regime in Juba than did the American colonies to cut loose the bands that held them to the British monarchy. Indeed, it is our position that in many respects the Nuer have a greater right to succeed than did the Americans. The American colonies and the British were the same people. They spoke the same language and they were members of the same ethnic group. In fact, one was simply a colony of the other. While the Nuer and the Dinka are more or less members of the same genetic stock, they are not the same ethnic group. They do not speak the same language, nor do they have the same political or social culture. There are similarities, of course. They belong to the same civilizational sphere, but that doesn't mean that they're the same nation. By all rights, and by the modern state system of the world, the Nuer should have their own state. It is doubtful that any arguments to the contrary can come of good faith. The Nuer already live and organize themselves as a separate state, something that was recognized generations ago when the British Empire occupied South Sudan, or Sudan. They had problems with the Nuer. It was therefore decided that an anthropologist would be sent among them so that the British authorities might have an understanding of what made the Nuer so different from other groups. The said anthropologist was a man by the name of Evans Pritchard. He after some time interacting and living among the Nuer, described them as an acephalous kinship state. Evans Pritchard's use of the word state was no accident. He well knew the distinction between a state and a nation, and for him, the Nuer were a nation that had created a state that they, the Nuer, understood in their own terms. Many facets of Nuer society, from social organization and thought, have been studied and even celebrated by academics around the world. In the introduction to part two of the rules and meaning, Mary Douglas argues that an analysis of Nuer society is a perfect illustration of the Wittgensteinian principle that the whole of logical space is given when one place within that space is determined, within that place is determined. Douglas writes, the logic is as soon as one place and it is determined. A passage such as this one, chosen from Wittgenstein's Tractatus, is exactly illustrative. Society for the Nuer are supremely logical. Our social organization has been likened to the organization of pre-monarchic ancient Hebrew society, and some have proposed that the segmentary nature of Nuer society and lineage structure may offer a model in helping to understand ancient Hebrew social and political thought. Other areas of Nuer thought, such as also garnered academic interest. So, this is post-World War II Europe. This looks a lot like the Europe we have now, except, you see that, right? In particular, the line going through Germany. 1989, the Berlin Wall fell. It was literally a wall going through Berlin to mark off the communist side and the non-communist side, right? But for the most part, things look similar. You see Yugoslavia. Yugoslavia doesn't exist anymore, right? Because what happened? The Yugoslavian War, Josip Tito died. He was the guy that was sort of holding all those various ethnicities together. When he died, what happened to Yugoslavia? It broke apart into their various ethnicities. Is there any more fighting in the area that used to be Yugoslavia?
No.
Not anymore. So, thus the Nuer are a nation and that they had succeeded in forming a social system sophisticated enough to be called a state was recognized by foreign thinkers, years before our time. Even the fact that the Nuer made a strict division between themselves and Neitanath and Djur indicates that they had a very clear idea of themselves as a separate people. To them, only a Nuer person is Aran, but all others are Djur. It matters not if they're Jew or Sholo, English, Dinka, Arab, Chinese, etc. They're all Jew through the Nuer mind. Their division of the human world into only two important classes indicate not only the deep chasm they see between themselves and other peoples, but the deep respect and value they have for one another. Nor does this deep respect and value for one another mean that they're going to be oppressive towards other groups. It's just to state that they have a very clear understanding that we are Nuer, so there's a strong national identity in that respect. That strong national identity does not mean contempt for other ethnicities. That association is often made, and I think it's a dangerous association. So, our work now is 21st century Nuer, so equipped with education, wealth, and technology as we are, and with our great numbers, should not be to seek an undoing, but rather a perfecting of what our ancestors began. We should not timidly shrink from the lofty destiny these people outlined for us by those who came before us. Our ancestors knew themselves to be a people on the earth, who stand independently of all others and have the divine right to determine their own future. Why should we let such a worthy vision die with us? And in our time, when it is at this time that we are at most need and most equipped to fulfill the vision of generations of Nuer before us. Shall we allow all their work and legacy to perish with them, or shall we prove ourselves to be the rightful heirs of this competent and dignified people? That is the question that lies before us today. How much more time do I have? 15 minutes? Good. The Nuer are not asking for land that is not already theirs. Nuer land already exists. We're not asking to cut up somebody else's land. We're not asking to extend our borders. We're just asking to give something that's rightfully, or to even codify something that's rightfully theirs as theirs. That's all this being asked you. So it cannot be argued that Nuer secession from South Sudan requires a land that is somehow an artificial construct that has to be cut out of already existing lands that belong to other peoples. That's not what we're asking. There is a distinct territory that is undisputed as the corporate estate of the Nuer people. It belongs to no other group of people other than the Nuer people. It is therefore the Nuer people that possess the right to determine how it is to be governed, by whom, and to what political system it is to be affixed. There is a tendency among some Nuer intellectuals to pour contempt upon traditional Nuer political structures. These people think that the old ways are backward and see in them nothing salvageable. These intellectuals could not be further from the truth. In fact, such thinking belies the limited grasp of the meaning of Nuer traditional political structures, political and social structures, and often of the origin and meaning of Nuer political thought and structures. These people are often competent in listing the various rights, histories, and personalities of the traditional Nuer system, and they show very little understanding of the underlying, but rather they show very little understanding of the underlying theory of these practices. In essence, these intellectuals know the letter of the Nuer system, but nothing of the spirit of the Nuer system. If they understood the spirit of the Nuer system, they would see that it is in fact a decentralized federation of Nuer tribes. Naturally, such a system works well for the deeply egalitarian and democratic political structure of the Nuer people. We must recognize this if we are to construct a political system in the 21st century that is suited for the Nuer mind. Any political system that is to be built must follow as closely as possible the pre-existing political and social convictions of the people so as to not rub against deeply seated sensibilities, thus preventing a great deal of political instability and facilitating the effective administration of any state. Any political project that fails to heed this warning will always and must always meet with failure. In the creation of a modern Nuer state, we must therefore stick as close as possible to the Nuer political thought and the concepts which those thoughts are expressed. The early Enlightenment thinker, Niccolo Machiavelli, seems to have thought that the hardest thing to do was to found a new mode and order. In the establishment of the United States, checks and balances, it is fair to say that the American founders responded that while the founding of a new mode and order is difficult, it is not the hardest thing to do. According to the Americans, the hardest thing to do is to determine what to do with the legislators that are born into the already established order. The founding of a new system requires individuals of great natural ability. The problem is when such individuals are born within the new order and wish to establish their own mode and order within the existing system. The inextricable result is that the ambitions of the new builders will militate against the established order. The system of checks and balances was intended to frustrate the ambitions of these would-be legislators. In other words, you could say would-be dictators. That's why we have checks and balances to make sure the president isn't too powerful, all these sorts of things. So naturally, the Nuer state would eventually face this problem. In fact, the Nuer mind is aware of this problem, and so one will find in traditional Nuer political arrangements a dizzying array of social practices and principles that tend to make it very difficult for individuals to amass so much power as to be able to rise to the level of universal tyrant among them, at least for any considerable span of time. Nuer have a deep awareness and aversion to tyrannical rule and the oppression that comes along with it. No greater examples of this need to be displayed other than their determined, sustained, and fierce resistance to the philosophy of Dinka supremacy that Dinka elites are working hard to establish. That said, any would-be tyrant among the Nuer would find their aims frustrated with the same ferocity that has characterized Nuer resistance to British, Arab, and Dinka attempts to curtail their freedom and diminish their sense of dignity. Just as mighty Lonar was felled by a glittering spear from heaven, so every Nuer that would seek to exercise tyrannical rule over his own people would be broken by the nature and structure of Nuer society. So, a little footnote about Lonar. I'm sure some people have heard that name, right? So, there's this legend about this man. I think among the Nuer, the legend might be shared by various other peoples around the area too. But there was supposedly this great, tall, powerful man, and he wanted just to be a tyrant. And no other man could defeat him in war if people grouped up together or they just fought him individually. But he had a really perverted mind. He would eventually say that I want to build my house out of the living bodies of men and women. So you have the tall people. I can't remember if it was the tall people that would form the pillars of the house, or it was the short people. Exactly. Okay, so the short people. Exactly. And then when one of them dies, he just goes and gets another person to replace him. So he's literally got living shingles. So this is the story that's told, but we often don't ask, why do people tell this story? It's because deep in the mind, there's this fear of the tyrant. Because that's a symbolism for what the tyrant does. The tyrant wants to live in a house made of the suffering of other people within the society. So, to that end, a formalization and codification of the relevant portions of Nuer society is needed in order to produce a working system of checks and balances suitable for a modern state. We can't just have stories forever, we have to eventually put down and codify these rules. Such formalization is not ventured upon in this work, but is something that Nuer thinkers need to do. We insist that the creation of such a system be accepted as a necessity. Key things that need to be sorted out is the structure of the Nuer federal government, whether there should be a unicameral or bicameral house, the powers of the executive branches and those to be attributed to provincial / state governments, and the internal structure of an independent judicial branch. While I don't speak on the exact order of the three branches of government, we can assert with confidence that any allotment of powers to provincial governments that is just shy of the devolved parliamentary system that exists in the United Kingdom may be best for the Nuer system. This means the means by which such officials are elected should be carefully considered in more detailed future work. But as with the case of the branches of government, there are general remarks that can be made here. It is clear, for instance, that in the case of a bicameral system, that senators, as well as members of parliament, should be elected by the citizens of the province from which they come. And by provinces here, I think we've already essentially got provinces or states. As I said before, the Nuer are a federation of Nuer tribes, of Nuer-speaking peoples that have the same culture. And so there would be no need to say, well, we have this problem forming states. Well, look, where do the Low Nuer speak? Where do they live? Oh, in that area? Okay, that's a state. Where do the God Yob live? That's a state too. In other words, the various tribes that they have in their territories would just form the new states. They've already got that. Why would you create a system that seems to butt against what they already think of themselves? Better to start with what people already have and get along well with, and then to build your edifice upon that, rather than saying, what you've got is garbage, let me put something else in. Which is precisely the problem that seems to plague us constantly. So in keeping with the sectional nature of Nuer intranational politics, it may be best for senators to be elected by an electoral college on a rotational basis. The Nuer state constitution would thereby have legitimacy and thereby have legitimacy. So I think the time is up now. I've got a great deal more things to say, but I'll just wrap up by going through the slide again. So there's a few things I'd just like to say here now. So I talked a lot about how Africa was divided. So the work was done at the Berlin Conference on West Africa, held by this man here, this guy, Otto von Bismarck. There's a picture of him on the internet that's really aggressive. He's got this helmet on. It's just like, you know. But he was you know, the guy who was sort of responsible for this German, not so much an empire, but yeah, I guess it was somewhat an empire. He really wanted Germany to unify and have greater national prestige. Then there was the issue of how to divide up the new colonies in Africa, because people, various European powers would arrive on coasts, and then of course, they'd be like, well, I have this entire area, right? And another European power would step in and say, well, no, I've got this area. So there had to be a way to determine how the continent would be divided so that there wasn't war among the European powers. Of course, it's really hard to do that because the continent is quite irregular and huge. For instance, speaking here about the Nuer state, you might say, well, look, the Nuer are really small people, their area is small and so forth, right? But then you look and you say, okay, well, let's see where Switzerland is. So the projection would suggest that like Europe is really, really big, right? But for instance, like Nuer territory is about 35,000 square miles. Switzerland's about 15,000 square miles. So Nuer territory is about 2 times the size of Switzerland. So that's how big the continent is, right? The east-west axis, the north-south axis, is quite large. It can fit a lot of the biggest countries around. So there is no shortage of space. And in terms of the people, the African population density on the continent only matched the population density of Europe that Europe had in the 1500s in 1975. So of course, and now the people are growing larger in numbers. So what happens when these various ethnic groups that have existing animosities, instead of them being 100,000, now they're 4 million people? I mean, I suspect that if there's a war, more people are going to die, right? So why don't we just take the pressure off of this cooker and say, well, look, you guys have your area. The people from the other side are not going to come and take yours. So that's a simple thought that I'm saying, right? So Africa is quite huge. So during the West Berlin Conference, one suggestion was that, okay, wait a minute. Why don't, if you land, say, I don't know, on this side, right, or on this coast, then they called it the hinterland theory, then you have control indefinitely inward. Until you meet somebody else who's like, oh, no, I'm here, and then you have to leave your body and let me out. So at one point, like, France landed in Algeria and was like, all right, well, I'm at the coast here, so I have a right to the hinterland all the way to the Cape of Good Hope. I mean, that was one serious suggestion, right? That should just state, like, how, like, so then, if the land was divided in this way, why would you feel that you're somehow, that it behooves you to stay with states like this? I mean, if I just said, well, you know, there was a guy from France who was like, well, I landed here, so then therefore I can control everything here. And the only thing that stopped him was that
The English guy was maybe like, no, I'm already here, and I'm extending this way. And then some other person was like, no, I'm here, and I'm extending this way. And then it's like, well, okay, I guess we'll have to make it like this. Right? That's literally how the countries were established. This is a map of Africa in 1914. Doesn't it look very similar to the map of Africa in 2017?
Except
the South Sudan is different. Exactly. Except the South Sudan is different. And then a few other things too, right? But it looks essentially the same. Right? Like for instance, the Congo is bigger than Western Europe. Sudan, when it was unified, was bigger than all of Western Europe. So, this is a map of Africa in 2017. Not much difference. But the population's increasing, and we're seeing a lot of wars. Like, so much so that people comment, look, Africa's really good for making large humanitarian problems, but no meaningful politics. So, like how long are we just going to continue with this, right? And as I'm speaking about nationalism, and I'll say things like, well, look, the Nuer people need to develop, and they need to have their own land so that the resources of the land can go to developing the people. This might seem really distasteful to people, like, ooh, nationalism, I'm not sure about that. How can nationalism help develop a country? Well, this man, Friedrich List, Friedrich or Frederick, the Americans call him Frederick, but it's Friedrich German, I think. This guy wrote a book called The National System or the National System of Political Economy in 1841, in which he argued against Adam Smith's The Wealth of Nations. And Adam Smith's The Wealth of Nations, Smith was an economist, so was Friedrich List, and Smith was arguing, was an Englishman, argued that, look, the way to become wealthy is to have free trade, no tariffs between countries, and then once you've got that, the invisible hand will sort of make sure, and there needs to be, government has to get out of it, and once you've got that, the invisible hand of the economic system will make sure that wealth follows and comes to everybody's hands. And then Friedrich List was like, no, I don't buy that, that's not true, you're just saying that because you're an Englishman, and the English were already well-developed. Vis-a-vis the Germans, right? The Germans at that time, their national unity wasn't as strong. Their industries were not as strong. The English industries were stronger. Their national unity was stronger. They had reached that point much earlier because of, as we spoke about, the breakup of the Holy Roman Empire and what that meant for Germany, what state it left Germany in. So Friedrich List was like, in fact, the English had used their government to institute protectionist laws for their industries. In many cases, by putting such protectionist laws that forced German steelmakers out, right, and Dutch and so forth. And so then they nurtured their infant industries. They established these things that developed their people. Now that they're developed, they're like, hey guys, there should